Okay, everyone. So for our last session today, we have our keynote speaker, Farzad Mahootian. Farzad is a clinical associate professor of global liberal studies at New York University. He has an interdisciplinary background in philosophy and chemistry, focusing on their intermingled histories. And so he'll be talking to us about slipstreams and how, well, slipstreams and how to navigate them. So please give a round of applause to Farzad to welcome him to our stage.
Thank you, Taline. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm really thrilled to be here. It's kind of unbelievable, as many people have said, going through life for decades and decades, kind of holding this in and keeping it secret and all that, but there's a charm to that, I suppose. But I'm happy to be here. I thank you in advance for your generosity, for your compassion, for the topic for me as I make my way through this and offer you some mistakes along the way. I have questions, some of which I know what those questions are, some of which I don't, but I'm hoping you will, and we can talk about that. So I thank you for your openness and flexibility. All those things that psychedelics are supposed to do for your brain and your mind, I hope that's happening right now. So let's go. So a tiny bit about me. I was born in Iran. I came to the United States when I was about four. I learned about Huckleberry Hound and the Jetsons and Fred Flintstone, so that was my socialization. Went back when I was about 10. So potty training and language acquisition in Iran. Cartoons, America. And then I went back, puberty in Iran. So another formative period. So then I came back again, just in time to be extremely confused and embarrassed in high school, American high school, and how that worked. It was like such a culture shock. Then I continued this back and forth thing by going into chemistry and pre-med first, then back to philosophy. Well, not then to philosophy, because I didn't find what I wanted there, and I discovered it existed, epistemology and metaphysics. Then I went back to chemistry because I found some things in chemistry that seemed to support, in a way, substantiate the metaphysics. It was sort of physical embodiment or confirmation of some of those metaphysical ideas. It turned out it was Whitehead that was the philosophy, and it was the chemistry of non-equilibrium systems, basically complex system dynamics in chemical form, that drove me back to get a master's degree in chemistry, which was a crazy thing to do after 12 years of not studying chemistry. Then I went back to neither of them. I started to teach because I forgot to look for a job. And the only thing open was, well, our chemistry teacher just didn't show up. Would you like to teach high school kids chemistry? So that education got me to thinking, like, science education, which I thought already sucked because it was soulless, I had to now do it. It was my punishment for reading Kuhn and really liking it. And so I was like, oh, yeah, I'll do it better. Which I didn't do. It was hard. It was hard to do. But I did try to bang around and learn some things about it. I got anything I could from government agencies, National Center for Supercomputing Applications. I learned some of that and visualization. I went to NASA. And I left that all, did a little bit of science education software development, Earth system science stuff. That was wonderful. And that got me to the whole Gaia hypothesis thing as it was taking place by remote sensing satellites on the Earth, a whole system of satellites that observed the Earth in order to basically advise Congress in a language that was not exceeding the fifth grade, you know, Congress. I'm honest to God, that's what they told us. You have to speak in the what normal people understand, and that's what. And so that was meant to essentially support climate change policy back then. This is the late 80s, early 90s. Anyway, I did that for a while, and then I got fed up with not teaching because I was now, in a development company doing science education. And I missed teaching, I missed students, I missed young people, I missed actually professors and teachers because I was just dealing with adults. Trying to manage adults. I mean, can you imagine? Some of you can. I know Adrian has done something like that. So anyway, that's my background. I went back to teaching philosophy and chemistry. And then, so I say all this because I've been between things for my entire life. I realize I am the embodiment of the philosophy that I am going to talk to you about. And I didn't realize that explicitly until recently, that that's just the way things have gone. And that's good because I think it's the right way to go. So I'll just start because... So what's a slipstream? In case you don't know, this is my very kind of baggy definition, but essentially it's when you get, if you've seen birds flying in the back of ships, what they're doing is taking advantage of the different energy environment behind the ship. The currents, the air currents are different back there, and they can just kind of lazily hang out and ride those with putting less energy in there. And then if you have two things moving, is I'm imagining, you know, the tunas that I was just talking about, then you would have some really interesting dynamics, vortices and nonlinear things happening. And when you get a nonlinear flow, you get things that can spontaneously occur. They're metastable. They're not exactly going to stay the same, but you get emergent things coming in and going out. It's wonderful and various. And that's what I'm hoping to do with this idea. My original title said Navigating Conceptual Slipstreams. And then I thought, it's much more than conceptual, as we've heard. So I just took that out, and I don't know what to put in, so we got stars. So various conscious fluxes, including conceptual, imaginal, verbal, sensual, and other. Navigating, simply steering, intentional waymaking. You can think of it in any way, but it involves negotiation. It's not just control. That's not happening. We're in a nonlinear situation. Control is not what is... you have a false expectation if that's what you want. So I don't know why I went Latin, but I just, it was time to go Latin. And I don't have a slide number two for this because I ran out of time. But we'll see some more opposites later. This is the Socratic ignorance chapter of the talk, and we'll get to more of that. Whitehead, in case you don't know, is a big fan of Plato, and the whole... The history of Western philosophy is a series of footnotes to Plato is his statement. And his, in particular, is consciously trying to update or bring Platonic thinking to bear on science and philosophy. And so these are two statements by him. Well, first, let's do the Socratic ones. These are my words again, thinking what I think is a good justification for not staying in one field of study like a normal person would and just getting tenure where you first got your job, which is what I didn't do. So if you don't do that, it becomes a little bit more difficult, but it's doable. And you're always not the specialist. And I found that to be, that's the conversation I was having with Johanna. I found that to be really enriching, even though you're just always not completely in balance. and those people really help because they ask questions no one else would. Okay, the most important thing I know is that I don't know. That's definitely Socrates. That is, my ignorance dwarfs my knowledge, and whatever else I know is of secondary importance. That's a longer way of saying I don't know anything, which is what he said. But he was, you know, he's a liar. He's Socrates. He's ironic, so he did know something, obviously. The history of ideas is a history of mistakes is Whitehead's version of doing history of science and with the Socratic spirit. And he goes on to say, I mean, science, when it's good, is correcting itself. So at any given time, there are errors. It's riddled with errors. We don't know where they are. They're not huge, but they're present, and sometimes they are huge. And then this last thing that really gets me, I love this statement, it's more important that a proposition be interesting than that it be true or false. I looked up Max Black. You'll see his name coming up with reference to metaphor later. And he says this beautiful thing about metaphor, that it doesn't have a truth value. It's not truth or falsity. But it's extremely useful, as we've heard discussions already today. Whitehead adds a little footnote to that, which is if it's true, it kind of adds to the interestingness, but it's enough that it'd be interesting because it moves things, right? Okay, so here's what I would like to do. And these are not going to get the same amount of time, but they're going to get some time each. What I want to build up to is this cross-scalar transdisciplinary model. And so I have a bunch of slides that lead up to that, maybe too many, so I may skip one or two of those. On the way there, I want to address something about perception. This is Whitehead's theory of perception being a symbolic reference between causal efficacy, the causal flow of the past, and the presentational immediacy right now. We'll get into that in a bit. But his point is that symbolic reference basically drives the creative advance of knowledge, but it introduces lots of error along the way. That's just how it's going to work. So it does both very well. This is why we misperceive things. This is why our first impressions are so interesting. anyway, this last point is something that I saw in Whitehead and Plato. Whitehead says it explicitly, and then I learned also Jung says something very much like this. It's the attitude toward the contents of your mind that matters more than the actual contents. Sure, the contents matter, but your attitude toward these things contextualizes significance, and then from there, directionality, a gradient forms. And I'm not sure what attitude means, but I have one, I guess. Here's the quotations. You can see them happening here. Whitehead says this very explicitly. He says before this that one doctrine is as philosophical as another doctrine. They're not automatically philosophical. Doctrines or propositions are not inherently philosophical. What makes them philosophical is this. It's an attitude toward doctrines ignorantly entertained, and by ignorantly entertained, he has a very high bar. I mean that the full meaning of the doctrine in respect to the infinitude of circumstances to which it is relevant is not currently understood. And that's basically an infinite set, maybe two or three of them thrown in that statement. Jung says something very similar. I got this from Jana's chapter from the book that just came out. This idea of integrating individuation in Jung, he also says it depends entirely on the preparedness and attitude of the conscious mind, whether the eruption of these forces and images and ideas associated with them will tend towards construction or catastrophe. So again, all of this energy can go different directions, as we saw earlier in today's panel. Okay, I had mentioned in my abstract, I mentioned a lot of things in my abstract, many of which I won't hit, but Sandra Harding, who I referred to earlier, this is the definition of objectivity, of scientific objectivity. She's a philosopher of science, a famous feminist philosopher of science, along with Longino and others. This idea has been coming along. It's very, this is a great book, and this is a very concise statement of it, but it's things that we've heard again. This is very similar to Christine's work and that of others, but there it is. After all, why should those with commitment to democratic and social relations want to support sciences that can produce highly reliable results of research, but are funded to do so primarily in response to the concerns of militarism, corporate greed, and the investing classes in the global north? She's very aware of the whole world in this statement and their allies around the globe. Why should reasonable people take this research to be value free? It has never been that way. And we discussed this with reference to psychiatric stuff with Sabina a moment ago. So, and this is Christine's, this is from the new book. There's the cover. And again, more articulate here, three ethically problematic colonizations are imminent in the clinical appropriation of psychedelics, namely the instrumentalization of both extraordinary personal experiences and the indigenous knowledge practices and their commercial appropriation. Rather than liberating us from the alienation and disconnected individualization that a capitalist order breeds, the assimilation of psychedelics into the medical industrial complex restricts individual freedom and proceeds through cultural appropriation, pretty much business as usual. And if we don't attend to this and don't comment on it. It's wonderful that, you know, the questions about ethics and science that come up originally going back to the Pugwash conference, this was after the atomic bomb. Einstein, these people pulled together like 10 Nobel Prize winners, including Einstein, come together and they start to talk ethics of science, realizing this is a new kind of ethics. That was what, 70 years ago. And then ever since then, ethics tries to catch up with science every time there's a new technology development. So we get like, oh, well, we're going to need it for stem cell research. We're going to need it for nanotechnology. We're going to need it for... It always comes a little bit after the fact. This is kind of before the fact. We're at the very beginning of this, and that's great. So just to be mindful, this is still, you know, doable. Got to make noise. So I think I can skip this. You all know what it has revealed. The thing that stuck out for me is the predictive capacity of subjective experience in some experiments. And this is the whole controversial mystical experience thing, but there's some findings, there's some data. The thing that stands out for me is that subjective experience is being given objective importance, being given predictive value. At least the attempt is there. It's something to look at. I think that's kind of new and good to follow. Okay, now let's talk about the history, perception. How does perception work? Looking back, since I've been working on this thing for weeks now, I don't remember exactly why I wanted to include this, other than the fact that the perceptual changes at the onset of a psychedelic experience are really intense. And from the very first time I experienced this, I wanted to know what's going on, how does this work, and so on, all the stuff that everyone else wants to know. So I know why. My attention was drawn to it by Lenny Gibson's paper on LSD, probably one of the first, probably the first interpretation of the LSD experience from a philosophical point of view, again, Whitehead. And he drew attention to this. And I was familiar with this theory of perception, but I hadn't thought about it this way. So, okay, so let's look at it. And a little bit of introduction here. Psychedelics relax the precision weight. Oh, this is from, I believe, I forget where this is from. I apologize. I think this might be Carhart-Harris, a quote from that. It's the Rebus paper, basically. Yeah, it's the Rebus paper. And he's saying the psychedelics relax the precision weighting, that is to say, of internal predictive models, thereby allowing bottom-up information. This would be the causal flow of the past, all the stuff that's hitting us that we ignore in order to just do our jobs. That kind of comes to the fore with psychedelic experience. And the presentational immediacy, the TV screen that we're watching, we treat all reality like a TV screen, that recedes as the force of the bottom-up experience sort of gets more insistent. So how does Whitehead explain this, or how does Lenny interpret Whitehead, which I agree with? Peter also wrote something about this in his last book, the book that just came out, the same idea going on here. So three of us agree. Whitehead's, for him, perception is a symbolic reference of causal efficacy of the past to the presentational immediacy of sensory inputs of the present. So basically, something's going on in front of you, and what you're going to do is you're going to draw on that enormous file cabinet of the past and selectively pull out bits or reasons, which I won't go into. It's selective, so it's going to be a value judgment. That's why it can be wrong, that's why it can be right, but it's definitely a sort of significance targeting of the present moment, what matters now. And Western cultures, have favored, I guess, since about Hume's time on and his wonderful analysis of perception, favoring presentational immediacy as the only mode of perception and sort of neglecting the other one altogether. The other one is also what Bergson, you know, was on about, as we heard with Adrian's presentation regarding Huxley. So that one's the invisible one. This one's totally visible. Now, there's a proportion between these two, between the causal efficacy and the presentational immediacy, that stays pretty standard while you're sober, most of the time. Under stress, That's the other reason I quoted Carhart Harris in this article, or maybe it was the PIMS article, I think, that comes up later. He says that under stress in certain other situations, you get a similar fluctuation as you would in a psychedelic experience. That's pivotal mental system that happens, the pivotal change that can happen in your mental experience can happen under all these different kinds of conditions. But what happens from a perceptual point of view is generally this receding of the present. And so what I, the simple way to remember all of this is as P goes to zero, symbolic reference goes to infinity. And now we're basically somewhere in the middle of a very high psychedelic experience where we can't really distinguish and be useful in the present moment. But other stuff is happening. Lots of other stuff is happening. A lot of symbolic reference. Okay. So I think, can I get my phone? I just need to keep track of the time. Oh, here it is. Never mind. Got it. Okay. All right. So I think I will skip this one. I expect most people are familiar with pivotal mental states. So, actually, the key terms are really important. It's multi-level. It's the inception of a hyperplastic brain. We've heard of these things already. So let me go further down. Given that that's what happens, Brewer and Carhart-Harris support the idea of engineering an optimal contextual frame for the experience, set and setting, really taking care to change that thing in the kind of settings that Sabina actually mentioned just the previous panel. They go on to say this statement that psychedelic therapy and PIMS-based model are more generally are quintessentially biopsychosocial. And I think they cut it off too short because it goes beyond biopsychosocial in the manner that we heard from Johanna and the whole holobiont concept of the human being. We're really tied in beyond the social into the rest of the world. Traceably, chemically, we can trace down the interactions between microbes and fungi and actually look at the exchanges, how these things communicate. We're getting much, much better at this over the last 20 years. So it's there. It's not an idea. This really gives a precision to the Gaia hypothesis. Lynn Margulis had already done that with her symbiotic planet book, and we've just gone further than that yet. So it's not just a theory or a cool mythical idea that maybe scientific. And I think if we add that to the biopsychosocial concept, we enrich it in the right direction. Okay, so with this, staying with the pivotal mental states article, this is an image from that article. And they're trying to emphasize that the context of the experience will make a lot of difference. And you see the dark clouds on the one side and the sunshine on the other side. And there's a bifurcation. You can go one of two ways, right? And so, let's see, what is it? The fork in the road, river analogy is often used to reflect a bifurcation process. They do actually talk about complex systems somewhere in there as well. I won't go into there. Namely, a crossroads where trajectory of a system can rapidly destabilize and complexify. So I want to use the word metastable here because I'll use it later. Metastable means it could be stable in a variety of ways, but right now, it's basically at a high point of energy, and it's going to roll down the hill to one place or another. And that's what they're saying, and making it simply a bifurcation, although probably more than two directions to go. Brain entropy, spontaneous bifurcations increase with psychedelic experience substances. Contextual factors can be viewed as biasing currents in the river, influencing particular outcomes. Great. So now I put on my mythology hat. And what do we get? Psychopomps. If you don't know what a psychopomp is, it sounds kind of freaky, but only because it is. It is the conveyor of souls. Charon in Greek mythology. is, this is my drawing of what Charon does. It's a very special job. He has to transport every soul from the land of the living to the land of the dead. Now imagine having this job. Exactly. It's either the best job in the world or the absolute worst. You have to sit there, you know, you're trying to do your job and some guy's like, well, I want my life and my time. It's, oh God, one more guy telling me his life story. How good could that be? On the other hand, that could be just exactly, I guess, with the big corpus of Arrowwood, you're going to see. I mean, we know what this job is, right? So there's a deep mythological archetypal dimension to this activity. So I wanted to dig into that a little bit more. Socrates does this. He's referred to as a psychopomp as well, because he's taking you from what you believed to complete disorientation to somewhere better, hopefully. And it's not always successful. In fact, the people he does this to are not really pleased with the experience sometimes. They complain. And he's tricking them and he's messing with them all the time. Why? Why does Plato write this way? Why does the origin of, you know, really systematic philosophy and science sound like that? Why is it a dialogue? Dialogue, right? Between two. And here he's jumping back and forth. Plato is, or Socrates is, taking this position, taking that position, and really frustrating his conversation partners. He has to. That is the only way to go. You can't have one view. People talk about Plato being elitist. Yeah, that's only if you take him literally on some of the stuff he says. But if you take him metaphorically, mythically, I don't know, non-literally, pragmatically, he's a pragmatist. He's being persuasive. You can't really stick to any one quote. In any case, it's the thinking through conversation model. So I had the pleasure of doing parts of this talk for Irini and Johanna's series on consciousness conversers. And, you know, this is it. This is what you have to do. You have to converse. You have to bring in all the diverse voices to make it work. Okay, so moving on. That only took 3 minutes. I don't know how. Okay, so now here's the thing. The renunciation is really important. We want to be absolute in our concepts. Science wants to get the answer. The tendency to universalize, to absolutize, is not only in the province of religion. It's also in the province of science, which kind of grew up in the cradle of religion, of course. And that tendency is just not right. You know, and you can see that in a world of diverse opinions and understandings and cultures, but also the diversity of disciplines. They don't completely overlap. They don't all agree on what counts as good evidence or good theory. So there is a diversity already there. We just kind of don't pay much attention to it, or enough attention to it, I should say, unless we deliberately do so. Going back to that theory of perception, it takes a lot of effort to look at a chair and not see a chair. That takes work. Seeing a chair as a chair takes no work. So this work is difficult to do. It's going against the grain. Okay, so suspension of judgment becomes really important. And this is where, what does that mean? That means you're not adjudicating on truth and falsity. And as much as science wants to do that, and it should, that's part of the deal. This is Peirce's idea, Charles Sanders Peirce's idea of logic. There are three different kinds of logic. There's deduction, induction, and abduction. Abduction or hypothesis is where you are not working out truth and falsity. You're just trying things out. You're not concerned with that. But then you move on to the others as you can, as needed. But the abduction part is important. The suspension is important. That's where the new stuff comes up. Okay, so we have to be suspended between assent and denial. Emotional, contextual, conceptual polyvalence is evoked through irony, oblique references to myth, history, math, science, ritual, poetry, love, humor, art. This is how Plato rolls. This is how he writes. We get a little bit of that in some of the articles. I see little bits of that here and there in Carhartt-Harris. it's great. You're kind of departing from the normal rhetoric of science. You kind of play with it. I have to stop this right now and tell you my psychopomp story. Now that I remember, I wrote Brad Pitt there to remind us. Brad Pitt, okay, Brad Pitt, you know. I had a dream with Brad Pitt in it. And, you know, this is where I can horribly go wrong and totally ruin the last 8 slides of my talk. But I have to tell you about Brad Pitt, you know, because he's Brad Pitt. I saw a neuroscientist give a talk. He said there is a thing called a Jennifer Aniston neuron. Did you know that? Yeah. Yeah, there is. They had somebody's brain open for, I don't know, 3-4 days. They were doing some special deep work in there. And so they allowed some psychologists and other types of non-neuroscientist people to come in and talk to the person because they were conscious, just their skull cap was removed. And so they would talk to them, and because all the probes were in there, they could get some reads on what's going on. So they'd show them pictures, you know, and see how much rise they get. Homer Simpson would go by, and they'd like, oh, Homer Simpson, you know, recognize that. And, you know, most of them they didn't, but then Jennifer Aniston, like, bing! And it's a whole cluster. Not, they were not clustered. It was spread out throughout the brain, but one neuron devoted just to Jennifer. Okay, so Brad Pitt. I'm saying so Brad Pitt because Jennifer. Okay? All right. So here's the dream. So the dream is that, Tyson, Neil deGrasse Tyson, the very famous public voice of science, the would-be replacement for Carl Sagan. I thank you guys for hanging around. You've been here working all day. Your brains are just like, man. But, you know, I appreciate your working against that grain. But anyway, so Neil deGrasse Tyson, he does this thing on some podcast where he's being a little bit too loose and free, and the subject of altered states comes up tangentially, and he treats it like a 5-year-old would treat the word poop, you know, giggling. And it was like, that's funny. You know, a middle school response to altered states is just goofy giggling. And that's what he did. And I thought, dude, what are you doing? This is serious shit. I was disappointed, let's say, by that reaction. And, you know, it was a little bit of time passed. Early May, I go see my mom in LA, and I'm, you know, my clock's off. So I wake up at 3 a.m. from this dream where Neil deGrasse Tyson's coming up the walk. And I'm going like, great, I can talk to him now. So I say, okay, can we talk now? And the next thing happens is we're transported to a class in Exeter where I'm going to give this consciousness conversers talk. And so there he is with students, and he's going to make up for that sin of treating altered states trivially. And so like, it's not going well. It's just another lecture. And everyone's like, making their way through it. And I'm bored. I'm like, this is a disaster. So I'm just standing there waiting for it to be over. And Brad Pitt shows up, the hero of the tale. And he says, hop on my back. Gives me a piggyback ride, cycle pumps my ass out of Exeter to UCLA campus. Now, I don't know if you've ever been given a piggyback ride by Brad Pitt. I suspect most of you have not. But while I was getting that ride, I was going like, this is great. I mean, you know, he was like, go on. I was like, it was a good feeling. It was a very good feeling. So we get to the park, we get to the campus, there's grass, there's blankets, there's people who look like hippies having a good time. We go up to one of his friends and she offers us some weed. She says, want some weed? And we go, yes. And before we can even touch it, the very suggestion is already, I'm high. And so I'm standing there high in the dream, in the sun, and all of my attention goes into a teaspoon, the back of a teaspoon. Which in the sun, if you look at metal, because it doesn't actually have a surface, perceptually, a la Hume, we assume that it's a surface. It's not a surface. So the light hitting it is doing all kinds of chaotic stuff, and I'm focusing deeper and deeper into this thing. I fall into it, and I'm in my mom's hide-a-bed. Wide awake. And I'm thinking, okay, so I guess I got my lecture ready. I know what to talk about here. The the teaspoon became a portal. It became the chaos of colors, shapeless colors, dynamically moving. It added up to basically, oh, I didn't mention Brad Pitt had an apple. It was a psychedelic apple, and he gave it to me. So I got that going. So that's what that dream did. Now, I again, at this point, I'm glad I said that. I'm happy I said that. I don't remember why I really wanted this in here. I think it has something to do with Plato. We'll see. Let's keep going. So the opposites. Yes, we were talking about dialectic, putting together the opposites. I guess Brad Pitt and Neil deGrasse Tyson could be conceived as opposites. I don't know. But really, the important thing is this thing. We have in the world of Jungian psychology, individuation amounts to putting together the big opposites of the conscious and the unconscious. We have in philosophy the issue of subject and object that are supposed to remain. But regarding the mystical experience issue and being sucked up into the white light where you lose your individual identity, you lose individual consciousness. This is Lenny's opinion, and it's really, he says it's a fact. I think it's a fact, yeah, but it's a logical necessity. I believe the structure of this, and this is a language problem, maybe, I don't know, but let's just read what he says. The ultimate mystical experience is union with God, okay? It is impossible for a person to go any further, he says, and become God. At this point, a person would no longer be human. Because of this fact, human experience cannot truly transcend itself, nor can ordinary and extraordinary modes of consciousness be utterly disjointed. What I took this as is this troubling thing that, you know, the very first trip you have, the question is, why did it stop? Why do I have to come down? You know, why are there these two modes of consciousness? That's a troubling thing. And so integration is to help that, to, you know, heal that problem. But I think there's something in here that's more important that has methodological importance. And that is the line between subject and object. There always has to be one if you're going to be conscious, if you're going to be human, if you're going to have knowledge, if you're going to speak. All of these things depend on that logical division. So I'll just read. I can't extemporize this at all, but acts of self-knowledge make us both subject and object. You are the object and the subject that's looking at the object at really almost the same time. Is it the same time? It's close enough. But the idea is that the two become one, if only lightly. They still have to stay separate and temporarily. This is what the psychotherapeutic space is supposed to help you to do. To do really good introspection, to self-understanding, self-consciousness, self-knowledge. You know thyself, right? It is also the intensive space of transference and counter-transference, where things can go horribly wrong when you transfer all of your stuff onto the therapist and they, you know, return the favor if they're not paying enough attention, right? So it's a dangerous space, but it's a very fruitful, possible space as well. So this needs to be investigated. The reason I bring this up as a methodological thing is that all the interviews that are done with people who've had psychedelic experience needs to be mindful of this. The experimental arrangement of that interview needs to take these things into account. Any interview, there's going to be some influence of the interviewer on the interviewee. Yes, that's just normal. But this is a very deep experience, so more care needs to be spent on it. And so I bring up, to account for that, I suggest Bohr's complementarity. The idea of quantum wholeness, which his student Wheeler expanded to a cosmic scale. And let's look at that for a moment. The key fact comes down to this. It is an entwining of ontological and epistemological issues. They can't be separated. You're trying to gain knowledge from a physical system. So he says that this kind of complementarity, which is not required in classical physics, becomes required in quantum physics at the quantum scale because of these two reasons here. The objects of observation and the instruments of observation are nearly the same size. In order to have an observation, there has to be an exchange of energy, even if it's a photon, a single photon. So the second point, the exchange of energy required for observation affects and actually constitutes both systems. Now they're tied together. It's that two approaching oneness thing. But Bohr was insistent on the line has to be designated clearly. It doesn't become one system. The wholeness is you can't split it up arbitrarily, but you can design it so you know where your instrument ends and where the object of observation begins. And that's really what needs to take place between two people. They are on the same scale. There is an exchange of energy. And how much of your experimental setup is infiltrating your subject and shaping their response to you? You really have to account for that assiduously. So let's see. So yeah, these things, experimental design, interview protocol, and all of the metaphysical and epistemological assumptions that are built into those things, those questions that Peter and Joe are looking at. What are the metaphysical assumptions that people have, that a hospital has? What are their epistemological assumptions? Scientists generally don't really investigate that very much unless there's, you know, you guys special. But it needs to be looked at. That's the quantum layer. It's pretty complex. I won't get into all the details of that. It's unnecessary and irrelevant. But then when you come to things like the whole mycelial vision, the microbial vision that we heard from Johanna today, that's a level of wholeness that is observable and is actually experienceable all the time. And I think at this point, the deliberately chosen mythical name kind of hints at the coming together or the necessity for coming together of scientific and mythical narratives. The mythical narratives, which we usually associate with indigenous peoples, like, oh, they're indigenous peoples. You know, they're thinking mythically. They can't think like us. You know, we're logical. Obviously not true. We're mythical. You know, have you seen the stuff on Netflix? I mean, we are constantly swimming in myth. Right? So we don't acknowledge that. It's the shortcomings of language thing. We have to acknowledge what those are. We can't get rid of the languages. We just have to know what our misplaced concretenesses are, what our reifications are. And this is a good reification, the Gaia hypothesis. And these connections, okay, we got to move on to the model. I'll be stuck here forever otherwise. You have to tell me when to stop too. Oh, I don't know. No, don't tell me when to stop. Okay, I think I better run. So let's see. Okay, yeah, I can do that. Right, so metaphor is necessary. Gaia hypothesis, originally a metaphor, right? Metaphor is those, I'll break this down, I'm gonna stop reading. Basically, metaphor does this thing, it brings two things together, two words that are alike enough and different enough, and then the familiar one's supposed to help you out to understand the unfamiliar one. Now, the thing is that, really, any two things could do that. So let me just jump ahead to that. The coupling of any two words generates new knowledge. It just does. That's how our minds work, especially if we're really into the symbolic reference where we're really relaxed and letting anything be like anything else, more stuff cooks up. I'm going to skip this too. This is a little bit too detailed, but if you want an image, you can't get a better image than this one. The Ouroboros, the snake biting its own tail. This is the very image of self-reference, which keep that in mind. Self-reference is coming up again in a second. But this is the idea of something eating itself. There is an integration of opposites here. It should not be eating itself, but that is that kind of self-sufficiency that the planet already does display. The Ouroboros is that moment of self-consciousness, the subject becoming the object of its own desire, its own death. And let's just, this one I must read, I guess. The Ouroboros is a dramatic symbol for the integration and assimilation of the opposites, of the shadow. You project stuff on people. If you can take it back, you understand something about yourself if you become conscious of what you've just projected, right? So the Ouroboros is a dramatic symbol for the integration and assimilation of the opposites, of the shadow. It is said of the Ouroboros that he slays himself and brings himself to life, fertilizes himself, and gives birth to himself. I don't think there's much left, you know, the eating, the dying, the screwing, it's all done. It's all right here in the Ouroboros. It's a complete symbol. And that's the closest thing to what this planet is as a whole. The one insight I took back from my first major trip was that it was this idea of the universe consuming itself, every part of the universe consuming itself. I felt that. I didn't see it. It wasn't exactly visual, but it was this. I realized years later, it's the Ouroboros that I saw, felt. Okay. So this is my point about put any two things together. Some examples of that. The speed of light is limited. You put speed and light together, and I guess add a little Einstein, and what you find is that it's not an infinite velocity, but it not only changes the concept of light, it also changes the concept of speed. We understand that speed, velocity, is not one of those variables that applies universally to everything. It's an irrelevant concept when it comes down to information, for example. And if you know anything about the delayed choice experiments, good. I'm not going to explain them. But what happens there is information, it's the entanglement thing. If you know anything about entanglement in physics, it's simultaneous. It's not even simultaneous. You can't use these terms of no time, time, speed, fast, slow. All of those things are irrelevant in that idea of information. And you get to think, well, is physics being a shadow of logic? Or is logic a shadow of physics? I mean, which one is the real thing here? Not clear. Max Black's treatment of wolf and man, they affect each other. The man is wolf-like, the wolf is man-like. And then my idea is you could really put any two things together, any two things at all, and they will do that cross-fertilization thing. And there are other examples. They could be opposites. They could be near opposites. They could have nothing to do with each other. And pareidolia-wise, we will put something there. We can do that. Okay, so I'm going to wind down now. I got like 8 minutes to go. So I'm going to show you the model. As I get to the model, what I wanted to do is talk about that space in between the opposites again. That's where we are. We're not really on one side or the other. But that it's a metastable place, the between. It's not a comfortable place to stay. We need to settle one side or the other. And these traditions that I've mentioned up here are examples of that. Probably the most stark ones are in the religious practices. You have an eternal God. Then you have people in time. You have issues of opposites all over the place. And the religion is trying to handle one after another of really important opposites, life and death being probably the easiest set. Male and female, also difficult, but as the iconography shows, there's a lot of cross-gendering. It's not just Christianity either. I recently heard a talk about Hindu gods and Hindu concepts of gender, taking on gender, not taking on gender. It's there's a lot of ways to put together the opposites. Okay, so on my way to showing you my model, and here's the model coming up, I wanted to make a plea for transdisciplinarity. Transdisciplinary is a difficult thing for me to understand. I think I see it this way. Multidiscipline, you got a bunch of people working together, doing their own thing, but they're kind of parallel playing and they put their results together. Interdisciplinary, they start to use each other's methods maybe a little bit of each other's evidence, maybe each other's instruments, new things come out, really cool, interdisciplinary. Transdisciplinary, what is that? We're not really in the disciplines or between them. We're kind of, okay. So what I want to show you here with this set of, I guess, six examples is some structure. I don't know if structure is the right word, that is happening in all of these. It's kind of a hitting the limits issue. In math, we have Gödel undecidability. No? Yes? Yes, so no, right? No. Or the good old Monty Python skit, say no more. Say no more. So, okay, that's just math, you could say. physics and cosmology. There are limits inherent there, Einstein's light, Planck constant, delayed choice experiments, et cetera, et cetera. Information theory, we have, I'm tying that together with the cosmology, Bohr's complementarity, Heisenberg indeterminacy principle. The uncertainty relations show a limit to how much precision you can get out of position, energy, momentum, time. You cannot go any further. So these are all similar. I'm saying there's a through line here. And not because they have any connection physically. They're not exchanging atoms or anything. They're just very much alike. There's some structural similarity here. This is what I think of as transdisciplinary. Here's another one, Wittgenstein's rules for applying the rules that can't be in the rules. There's no way out of it. There's a limit to rules. And then the stopping problem, Turing. So that's supposed to soften you up so you'll be more charitable to this thing here. what I want to say is that there are some similar interconnections here that might be of use for us in psychedelic science. Now, people talk about doing things on psychedelics. Well, okay, we're doing science on psychedelics, right? So there's metastability arising from the polyvalence of words, metaphorical potentiation of semantic, syntactical, pragmatic, semiotic, et cetera, context. Metaphor does this. We know this. Metaphor is ubiquitous throughout language, all languages, and you can't get rid of it. It's in science. It's just not paid attention to. So the talks we had this morning, you know, it's like, pay attention to your metaphors. Very important. Rian's talk. That attention to metaphor is something that you see in some papers a little bit, but never enough. So every paper about psychedelics should examine the metaphors it's using about itself or about others. Yeah. So polystability of epistemological complementarity, we already talked about that, of subjective experience. You know how many different places it can go at any moment and stabilize. It's not restricted ever. Of symbolic reference, we talked about that in perception. Symbolic thought, cultural works, art, humor, religion. There's no end to these things, and they are full of possibility. And it does not end. Even when the doctrine comes down, it's the word of God, for God's sake. That thing mutates within a generation. I mean, it mutates as soon as it's finished being spoken. It's the whole history of religion and everything else. So we have this constancy. There's a similarity going throughout all this stuff. Now, the last bit here, this is as chemists, and I think I can end on this thing, is the metastability of complex dynamical systems. And I think this is especially relevant to looking at the human being as a holobiont, looking at all these levels and how they might interact with each other chemically, molecularly, contextually. These are all occurring at different scales, but you can possibly, I'm proposing, you can look for the links and the overlaps. You can cleverly set up an experiment to do a trophic cascade from one to the other, where the timing of the finishing of one cycle matches the next. And this has been observed already in ecology a lot, but the timing of one very large cycle coincides with a bunch of little ones, and it becomes an avalanche. It's called a trophic cascade, and it can go in different directions, but the most obvious one, there's a great video about how wolves, when they were reintroduced to Yellowstone, altered the rivers there. They did that because they, you know, it kind of stepped down from, they were predators, prey, how the prey behaved, then how the plants responded to the absence of the prey, and then how the plants and the river banks responded. And then within, I forget how long it was, 10, 20 years, a different landscape, just because of wolves being introduced back to Yellowstone. So that's an idea of how you can go cross-scalar with this stuff. That it did by itself. We could also design it, but studying how this works in symbionts is helpful. You know, this is the naturalism thing. It's not really naturalism. I'm just studying how nature does it. This is the whole idea of biomimetics, biomimicry. Study how it's done already in nature, and then replicate that structurally here in your work, in your experimentation. So Just to give you one picture here that's nice, and I'll end with this. This is the thing that I really am attracted to. Of all the images that come out of chemistry, and there's many, 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 many representations of chemicals, it's maddening. There's no standard way to represent a molecule. It looks like that in the textbook. Don't believe it. So here's something that I like. This representation is really fun. These are potential energy surfaces, so they're mapping energy. That's always on the y-axis there. And you see things coming in from one side, molecules coming in from one side. The top right is probably more instructive there. The entrance channel is, that's when you throw stuff into the vat. And then there are different sort of, the energy landscape will make it easier to go one way or another. You've got, you know, many Avogadro's numbers worth of these things, 10 to the 23, many, many times. So they're going to go everywhere. Some of them go in the most improbable places. Some of them will go directly to the easiest low energy places, but they will go everywhere. And they reveal this landscape. There's many possibilities. This is the metastability, the polystability possibility of just chemicals. Now, imagine what we could do with, ideas. Well, we have done that, but we haven't paid enough attention. And the whole drawing attention to industrial complex, the medical industrial complex, that's important to see that because they're part of the system. And if you don't have that in the system, you're missing some huge thing. And you're still calling yourself a philosopher of science? How are you doing? Well, I'm working on explanation. I've got a new model of explanation. I think it's really good this time. Yeah, well, you know. Okay, I was going to show you some clips, but I'm not going to show you, but I encourage you to see the movie Altered States. Sorry, it's going to start by itself. If you want to watch it, it's a whole minute and 45 seconds. Should I put it on for old time's sake? It's an old movie called Altered States, and the virtue of it is this thing. It does that epistemological, ontological nexus thing. The whole thing is a change of my mind that is that radical going to have a physical fallout? Will I change physically other than my brain chemicals? Can I make this manifest in the world? That's the romance of this fictional story. It happens to be the same romance of the magical worldview, of the Neoplatonic worldview, of all of these different mythical ideas. But here it is in 1980.
Matter of fact, Eduardo, my year in India was disappointing. No matter how you slice it, yoga is still a state-specific technology operating at the service of an a priori belief system. I must.
We scientists have a moral obligation to the public as well as to.
You can ignore these for a second. Thanks, it picks up later.
Shorten that time.
Really hurt to start yelling in a second.
Originally, man, another savanna living planet.
What dignifies the yogic practices is that the belief system itself is not truly religious. There is no Buddhist God per se. It is the self, the individual mind that contains immortality and ultimate truth.
What the hell is not religious about that? You've simply replaced God with the original self.
Yes, but we've localized it. At least we know where the self is. It's in our own minds. It's a form of human energy. Our atoms are 6 billion years old. We've got 6 billion years of memory in our minds. Memory is energy. It doesn't disappear. It's still in there. That's a physiological pathway to our earlier consciousnesses. There has to be an telling you it's in the goddamn limbic system.
Jesse, you're a wacko.
What's wacko about it, Mason? I'm a man in search of his true self. How artistically American can you get? Everybody's looking for their true selves. We're all trying to fulfill ourselves, understand ourselves, get in touch with ourselves, face the reality of ourselves, explore ourselves, expand ourselves. Ever since we dispensed with God, we've got nothing but ourselves to explain this meaningless horror of life.
You're a wacko.
I think that that true self, that original self, that first self is a real, mensurate, quantifiable thing, tangible and incarnate. And I'm going to find the fucker.
There you have it. That's it. Thank you for your attention. Appreciate it.